So let's say that I'm in London and you're inviting me over for lunch, and we're trying to schedule that. Now, first of all, over here on the right-hand side, I can actually see where you are, which is a boon when scheduling. I can also see what you've been tweeting about, which is fantastic. So I'm going to like this over here, like that. Let's actually head over to your profile on Twitter. I'm going to follow you. Now that I have your attention on an out-of-bound channel, I'm going to start replying to this email over here. I want to say, hey, Francesco, how are you fixed for lunch? Whoops, lunch tomorrow. And as soon as I type tomorrow, it actually shows me tomorrow, but I unfortunately have a lunch with the Delight team. So can't do tomorrow. But notice how where my cursor is, Superhuman is suggesting maybe I should suggest the next day. And that is Command Shift equals. So I'm just going to pop that out. It says Thursday. Nope, I've got one-on-ones. And it looks like Friday I'm actually free. And notice how when I did that, I didn't actually have to type anything. That just automatically updated what it was typing for me and sent out that email to you. And so we're going to take that to the next level, not just updating the email automatically as I flip through my days, but proactively suggesting times when it knows that I'm free. So that's the kind of thing we're going to look at on desktop. On mobile, we've got so much more exciting stuff to come. Something that I'm personally tremendously excited about is taking our iPad experience to the next level. So right now, our iPad experience is sort of a hybrid between what our iPhone experience is and what a fully fledged iPad UI would look like. We're really excited to make it a first-class citizen, bring the wonderful keyboard shortcuts from our desktop app to the iPad, and make it a formidable email device. Something that maybe you've seen from other guests is, I think 2020 is really the year where the iPad will take off, or it's already taking off as a first-class device for work. 17% of the iOS devices that we see are actually iPad devices. And it was never like that before. So this is really the time where we're seeing the iPad enter the workplace as a device that people use to get stuff done.
One of the questions that I think a lot of people have about Superhuman is the price. And you actually, we actually had a call before anyway, but you explained it to me. I did some thinking and reading around price and you convinced me, because like I understand obviously time is money and sort of around that. But maybe you can explain it for those who are like curious and worried about the pricing, I guess.
Sure. So for those that don't know, the price is $30 per user per month. And the way that we've priced this is to accurately reflect the value that Superhuman is creating for our users. So most of our users end up feeling hours back per week, and obviously many times that per month. And for the kind of users that we have and what they're doing with it, which is namely work, that is tremendously valuable. In fact, we often get the feedback from our user base that that's actually really cheap. And when you compare it to other things that they buy, whether it's Zendesk, the customer support tool, and the median price is $50 per seat, or Salesforce, where the median price is $150 per seat, it turns out to be one of the more value for money and cost-effective productivity tooling that they end up buying. So that's how we think about it. It's really in terms of the time that you save, and the value that you're able to create for yourself when you're using the product. And the one thing that I would add is, you know, we're coming from a world, and we're going to see this a lot over time, where for tools like email, there have really only been two solutions. Outlook, of course, from Microsoft, and Gmail from Google. And both of these are free or nearly free. And there is a cost that we pay for that. There's one that we've talked about in the media a lot, which is the cost of our privacy, as it were. We pay for it in advertising. But there's another cost as well, which is we end up using one size fits all solutions. And so in serving 1.5 billion users, Gmail isn't really thinking about folks like you or me. They're thinking about the average person, because you know that's what counts. Whereas for Superhuman, we really do get the luxury of focusing on the users that we have, and it's a very different kind of user. And because of that, we're able to build a solution that's much more tuned, much more focused, and much more effective. And that's really what we're selling for the price point that we have.